the whiskey mist would have done.
That or, yeah, chewing. I mean, you're slurping earlier. That
yeah, no, I always try to give you some sort of, you know, what is that called? ASMR or something?
Oh, yeah.
ASMR experience ASMR. That yeah. is trends with benefits.
Because I know you dig that kind of stuff.
Oh,
right?
Yeah, it's all I ever listen to. Just like soft whispering and slurping.
Lots of
new
S's.
Format for trends with benefits. I think that's clearly what we need to be doing. So yeah,
that's how you can go viral.
That's what we've been missing from this show.
We should all be eating stone fruit right now.
All eat stuff. There we go. Well, we figured out next like week's moist, podcast. Moist. Come watch us eat at Trends with Benefits. All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Trends with Benefits. This is our weekly Roundtable Tech Podcast here from Digital Trends, where we talk about the trending tech topics of the day. And we have a lot to get to right now. So in addition to being a podcast, we're broadcasting live on Facebook, Twitch, Periscope, and YouTube. And because of that, we can take your comments and your questions and your feedback. Even if we don't like it, you can type it in and put it up there. So let us know what you think about some of the things that we're going to be discussing today. So first off, later on in this episode, we're going to talk about a personal jet suit that you can buy right now at a department store.
So sweet.
I'm not kidding. Yes, seriously. I mean,
being
I
rich
might
must
even
be so awesome.
Yeah. I might just have to just mortgage my house and
walk on
know.
Down to JCPenney and get yourself a jet suit.
I'll pick myself up a jet suit today, man. I think. So we're going to be talking about that. We're going to be talking about some new 3D holographic displays that almost seem like Star Wars technology that's actually out there right now. We're going to be talking about the Lenovo Smart Home Display and the Samsung claim that they have created an unbreakable OLED screen, and they've got a video to prove it, so we're going to talk about all of that on today's episode. But again, we want to hear your comments and questions as we go through. But first off, let's introduce our cast of characters here. I'm Greg Nibler, and to my right.
Hi, everybody. I'm Kim Wetzel, Smart Home Editor.
Hello, Kim.
Hello.
I am Parker Hall. I am an AV entertainment writer, one of Caleb's minions.
Does he require you to say that?
Yeah.
Okay.
He gets a bonus. He gets a bonus.
You get a gold star at the end of the day.
Like, hold on. Sorry.
All right. And on the end, it's been a while since you've seen him here on this show. It is Caleb Denison, a.k.a.
The Whiskey Mist.
The Whiskey Mist. Caleb, now we do get fan mail for you sometimes.
Aww.
People actually? Missing your voice. Yeah, that's actually happened.
Really?
Yeah.
No, wait, really? Oh, man.
No, don't sound so incredulous, sorry, Parker. You just lost your bonus, dude.
There went your gold star for the day.
What's wrong with you?
But I am curious, since your nickname is The Whiskey Mist, like, what do you call your fans? I was thinking about this. Are they like Misties? Or
the Misties?
What's up, Misties?
Hey, my Misties. You know what? I've never had an opportunity to...
Wow. They're Whiskers.
That's really good. That is it. I'm going to ordain that right now.
What are they?
The Whiskers.
The Whiskers. All right. So a shout out to the Whiskers out there who have been missing.
You know, I haven't had a chance to really interact with them very much. So, yeah, maybe we should just I'll put my email address out there later in the show and you can email me directly.
Yeah.
In case there's an observation that you would like to refute or just tell me that I'm stupid or that I'm on Samsung's payroll or LG's payroll or Sony's payroll. By the way, I'm on none of those people's payroll.
Sure?
And if I did, I wouldn't be wearing this shirt 5 years after I bought it. You realize that I've been wearing the same clothes at this place for like 5 years.
Or maybe that's how you can say that, is that you...
You think plausible deniability of...
It's a disguise.
Yeah.
It's your Samsung.
It's a ruse.
You're going to jet suit out of here later.
Starting off with a rant for the Whiskers. So there we go.
That's how it goes when I'm on this podcast,
it is
Greg.
True.
You should know by now.
I know. There is no containing this podcast.
It's so weird because I rarely get accused of being in someone's pocket.
I want to be in someone's pocket.
Yeah. If anyone's offering, Dasani.
Well, let's talk about our first topic here before we're going to make way to the jet suit and all of that. But right now... we want to talk about what Samsung's new. So this is the trending topics right now in technology. And it's Samsung with their claim that they have come up with an unbreakable OLED screen. Now, for somebody like me who breaks phones all the time to where I have to have like a super thick old man OtterBox case here. I mean, it works. It doesn't break, but it's giant. I mean, I could
How's that feel in your pocket, by the way?
It's huge. It's huge. But I mean, I could definitely use something that is absolutely unbreakable, and especially an OLED screen. They've got kind of a video showing a little bit of what they're talking about, and I guess this thing went through the kind of rigorous testing that the Department of Defense would use in order to have an unbreakable OLED screen. And we don't know the price of it. We don't know when it's going to come out. It could be on the Galaxy X or Galaxy 10, whatever that's going to be called when it comes out later this year. But I think there's a couple of things with this. One, yeah, I want one. Two, I have trouble believing it because don't phone companies want you to break your phone? Isn't that kind of ultimately, I mean, you think iPhone, like Apple wants you to have an unbreakable iPhone you can have forever? I don't think, I just don't see it actually coming to fruition.
Yeah, you could be right about that.
Yeah, where they're just like showing this off for maybe one special circumstance.
It's like, we have this technology available, but we're not going to put it in our phones for a long time. It's like
$600 more for the phone.
Right.
Yeah, like, it's a $200 screen replacement three times. Yeah. Or
just because you have an unbreakable screen doesn't mean that you have an unbreakable phone.
True.
Like, that's true. I can think of all kinds of ways you can still break that phone. You can crack the case. You can break the lens for the camera. The button doesn't work, or buttons.
Right.
So buttons could stop working. There's all kinds of things that dropping a phone could still cause breakage for. But I'm not surprised to see this. You know, in the last couple of CESs, we've seen flexible OLED technology, a TV that literally rolled up and then rolled out.
So it's being designed.
It's kind of like, it seems revolutionary, but they've had this technology for a couple of years. They've been working it out, and they're now commercializing it. And so I'm not surprised to see this go in a phone. It just makes sense. You can put an OLED panel between plastic substrate, or in plastic substrate as opposed to glass.
Yeah.
It's obviously capable of taking a little bit of a beating and coming back. I think they will put it in a phone.
That's what's so weird is like, so
LG will
my too. Girlfriend has a phone, the Moto X Force. This is a like 2015 model, and it has an OLED in it, and it's like capable of being dropped like 100 feet onto its face and doesn't break.
Yeah.
So that's what's so weird about this is like, I've actually experienced this technology. Yeah. Like, I mean, she's dropped her phone straight onto the concrete, nothing.
Yeah.
What's weird about it though is that these phones, because it's plastic and not glass, it scratches.
Yeah.
I was gonna ask that.
Pretty scratched after a few years. But I mean, she's a rock climber and broke four iPhones before I finally made her get this like unbreakable Motorola.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they're still making these. So that's what my question was like, is this really new or is this just the first time Samsung's doing it?
That could be part of it.
I'm curious about the material that they have it sandwiched in or just underneath. I think that, they need to make it scratch resistant and really resilient outside of being not shatterable.
Yeah.
You can't shatter it, but also, let's not scratch it up. And
that was the complaint about the Motorola.
They may have used Gorilla Glass, you know, something that can really take a pounding. But if it's really scratchy, I don't think so. You know,
and what does the display look like, too? Is it, like, going to
Yeah, the difference between, like, my girlfriend's and mine, we had the same Motorola, but hers had that screen and mine didn't, basically.
Oh, as far as looking through that outer cover.
Yeah, like hers needed a lot more brightness to work because the screen was so much thicker.
Yeah, I could see it being kind of not as nice looking, I guess.
Yeah,
you know? Well, the OLED displays themselves are gorgeous. We know that. They're also susceptible to burn-in. So if you watch the same crap all the time,
the same then home screen.
You can... Yeah, exactly. You can definitely get some burn-in there. But, you know, I think... I know Samsung well enough to know that they're not going to come out with a half-baked product just to be able to say it's unbreakable. They'll do it as best they can. They'll do it before LG, because LG, also OLED manufacturer, also a big phone maker. They will come out with the exact same thing either just before or just after Samsung.
So Huawei is talking about bringing out bringing out a foldable OLED phone to try to beat Samsung to the market. Like, just something, who knows, you know, maybe $5,000, but just to beat them.
Well, IFA's coming out there. You know, the big consumer electronics show in Berlin will be there. So if any of this stuff comes to light, we are going to be covering it pretty much before any other U.S. publication, because we're going to be on the ground and immediately reporting on this stuff. So, we could find out. That, by the way, is at the end of August, beginning of September. So, I mean, it could be right around the corner.
So follow all the coverage there. We'll find out if there is going to be any more on that. Taking a look here just in the chat before we move on to the next topic, some of the comments. Brian said a forever phone would be quite a target for theft. Yeah, that's true. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously the internals, you know, will change and you would want to upgrade for that. Unless you're me and you're just fine with a, you know, 4-year-old phone. But there's lots of different comments coming through here about that. So we want to keep on seeing those as we talk about our next topics here too. So the next one is, Kim, something that you are very excited about, and your review is up there right now. We're talking about the Lenovo Smart Display Home Assistant. Maybe you can walk us through what this is and why it's so cool.
It is awesome. I really love this thing. We gave it an Editor's Choice Award. It is essentially a smart display. It's a smart speaker with a display featuring Google Assistant as your voice assistant. And earlier this week, I set it up right next to my Amazon Echo Show at my house, and it made the Echo Show look like it just a antiquated piece of technology, like an really? Old clunky TV next to this beautiful, like sleek looking device. It sounds great. It looks great. The screen is crystal clear. It comes in two different sizes, which is also something that the Echo Show doesn't offer. So it comes in an 8-inch screen or a 10-inch screen. And yeah, it's just, it blows anything Amazon Echo, any of the Amazon Echo devices just completely out of the
water. Now, the device itself, but I forget, are you on Team Alexa? Sorry for everybody whose speaker I just set off. Apologies.
It's bound to happen.
Or are you Team the Google Assistant?
I have 6 Alexa speakers in my house. I am probably Team Alexa.
Okay.
Honestly.
So I was going to say, is that just because you review a lot of them, or is it because you really enjoy using those devices?
I think it's a combination of both. I think until now, Amazon, the hardware anyway, was more interesting to me. I mean, yeah, the Google Mac speaker is pretty cool in terms of sound, but like I have the Echo Spot, you know, set up next to my, you know, it's in my bedroom, and I use the Echo Show for kitchen and stuff like that. So just in terms of versatility, I would say until now anyway, Amazon had Google Beat, and now with these third party smart displays, JBL's coming out with one, LG's coming out with one, and Lenovo has this one. I think that they're gonna really, like, I wouldn't be surprised to see like Amazon doing something pretty impressive in their announcement in September in terms of hardware.
They're gonna have to.
Yeah, well, they're going to have to.
I mean, with Google partnering with all of these different companies, I mean, that gives them just that much more of an advantage.
Absolutely.
You know, as long as the internals are working, you know, somewhat similar, to be able to have Lenovo come out with a display for you.
It's interesting to see that these guys decided to partner with Google for this device as opposed to seek out that kind of relationship with Amazon. I mean, I know Amazon,
but maybe Amazon's resistant to that.
Why would they be though? Because they license out the technology behind Alexa.
That's
to
true.
All these different companies that make speakers. So just because they make the display doesn't make sense given their history.
And you're going to buy it on Amazon anyway.
Yeah,
so they get
exactly.
a cut of it.
Yeah.
I'd like to see.
Maybe they see some kind of a future, or they've just, maybe they were just too confident in their section of that marketplace and didn't think anybody was going to come out.
I mean, maybe Amazon's going. I mean, they're not. They could come up with third party devices too. Like, I could see that happening for sure.
That's possible. And I'm curious for everybody who's watching live right now. You know, if you have a home assistant, do you use one of the video assistants? Which I guess is pretty much just the Echo.
Echo Show and the Echo Spot.
And Spot. So now with these new ones, would that entice you to get one more? I'll say from the review, and you can read it at digitaltrends.com too, and there's a video of Kim using it. I mean, I think it looks really cool.
What's the advantage, though, for having the screen? What do you like it most for?
Well, another thing that we haven't talked about is the fact that, like, you can get YouTube on this screen that you cannot get on the Echo Show because of the ongoing feud between Amazon and Google. You can't see those things.
That's
so
a big deal.
Cooking videos.
It's the first thing I think of, too.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
A very natural place for this device to be would be the kitchen. And so you can, you know, cook along with the video. Yeah.
Are any of these smart displays battery operated, or do they all have to be plugged into the wall?
At this point, other than the Echo Tab, which isn't a screen at all, it's all plug-in.
I mean, if it was wireless, I mean, that would just be a tablet, right?
Yeah.
Basically.
Yeah, it is. Because they currently, the Fires have Alexa capabilities.
Yeah, so that's really weird. Like,
they did just release a docking station for your Fire tablet to turn it into an Echo Show. That's another interesting thing that's going on there.
Well, but, I mean, isn't that just plugging it into the wall? Like, what's really different?
That's a good question. I'm going to be testing.
Yeah, probably processing. It doesn't have to run a ton of apps, right? The interface is probably really different, too.
I'm going to be testing it out in a couple weeks. I'll let you guys know.
Interesting.
How it goes.
Yeah.
Because that might be the better option, is that, like, if you can get a dock and.
You have an existing Fire.
And you get a Fire
Kindle
for,
Fire.
You know, even just a little bit more money, you get way more functionality out of a really similar device.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it will be interesting to see where it goes. I mean, do you think this one is going to be a big seller?
Well, it's $200. $200 for the small one, $250 for the big one. I think it's a good deal. The Echo Show is like $230, I think, when it's
on sale.
I worry
that Lenovo doesn't have enough like brand power outside of the computing world.
They're not like Apple.
When people think
people
smart
not even like
speaker,
LG or
they
something.
Don't think Lenovo.
Yeah.
Even.
Yeah.
Like,
right.
Yeah.
Well, but
see
props
about
to
that.
Them for doing
it
first,
though.
Right? And doing it well, I think.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And in addition to the other ones, you said JBL. And
JBL is coming out with one, LG.
It's a very Google move, right? Test the waters.
Right.
Partner with other companies.
Let somebody else do it.
Yeah. Somebody else fails. Do the work and somebody else swoop through and do it themselves.
Oh, yeah, there's the LG there.
Well.
it does not look as like sexy as the out a car smart stereo. Display for sure.
A question coming through just about home assistance, and I think it kind of this question speaks to the fact that I think still people are still very uneducated as far as, or not uneducated, it's not that, but it's such a new marketplace that people just don't know what all these things can do.
Right.
And the question is, I don't even like Siri. I wouldn't get a home assistant yet, but controlling the lights, a fan, the air conditioner would be kind of sweet with a home assistant of some kind. Do these do that? And yes, if you have the right devices, absolutely. Yeah.
You need to have a compatible smart home device to work with Google Assistant. But yes, that's what this device does, is it controls your smart home devices.
I think that's going to be one of the driving forces too. And I've said this before, is more once you start getting more and more smart devices in your home, they become more commonplace and less expensive, then people will start seeing the advantages of some of the home assistants. You know, obviously us in here, you know, we might be early adopters to that kind of thing.
Right. But I forget that not everybody knows, you know, and we call it a smart display. What the heck is that?
Right. Yeah. What is a smart display? So yeah, it's an interesting thing to see where it's going to be going. And again, you can read that full review at digitaltrends.com. But let us know what you think. So we've got to keep on going through our topics here today, because the next one, this isn't something that you're probably going to be getting anytime soon, but I think this kind of display technology is incredible, and it's from this company called Looking Glass, and it's right now designed for 3D content creators, but it's basically a 3D holographic display, which I think is something we've been hearing about, honestly, in smartphones. We've heard that somebody was going to be coming up with something like this, and it still has never really come to fruition. But this, it's like a glass box is what the actual product is, and it comes in a couple of different sizes. And inside of it, you can take your 3D created content, put it in there, move it around, take a look at it as an actual 3D display. You can move it, you can interact with it. Our review talked about using you could use your finger as like a torch, like moving it along the 3D display, and to actually mold and create this 3D content. That's where it's being marketed to first. I think something like this, if they can get the price down enough and they can start scaling this, that's that kind of entertainment that maybe we thought we were going to get with 3D televisions. That's my personal opinion. Obviously, a lot of people bought 3D televisions and then it just kind of went away.
It sucked.
They were real expensive and it was neat until you got one and you're like,
those glasses.
Oh. Okay, that's all this is. But this kind of thing where you don't need glasses and you can interact, I think there's something to this that I think that we could end up seeing utilized in a lot more devices. Like, it's almost like that cross of VR and television, but you don't need glasses to use it.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Caleb, what do you think about this kind of
technology? I've seen glasses-free 3D stuff in the past, and I've just not been impressed.
Right.
There's always this weird phase-shifty thing going on where you feel like you're being tricked, right?
Yeah.
And because you are. You know, it's messing with your field of vision. This is completely different. It has a real 3D look to it, and I agree with you 100%. I think that this could have big implications on future displays. I want to see it personally in real life. The pictures, when you're looking at a 3D thing on a 2D display, like, it just somehow it doesn't quite come across.
It's hard for them to advertise their own product.
It's got to be impossible to sell it without actually seeing it. So I want to check it out for myself, like, up close and personal. I'm hoping that it'll be at like one of the shows that we're covering in the near future, and then I'll weigh in. But like, our review praises it pretty well. So I'm assuming that it does have that awesome effect. And yeah, that would be great if we could watch TV like that at some point. I think that would be really fun.
Mm, yeah, and cool. Well, and there's interaction with it as well, because it works right now with, I guess, several different kinds of tools, even a Nintendo Switch controller, I believe it was. Mm. I'd have to verify that, but it can work with a bunch of different things where you can actually, interact with the device.
That'd be cool for games, for sure.
Games, a 3D holographic game, sports. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh my God, how cool would that
World
be?
Cup.
Yeah. And again, I think the whole
on your desk.
Awesome.
We already don't get enough work done around here when the World Cup is on. It's absolutely
once every 4 years.
Yeah. I mean, the whole thing without having to wear weird glasses, that's the huge advantage to this. That's where I think they're onto something. It's pretty expensive right now. That starts at $600 for the small version.
Headache free 3D.
$600 though, that's not I mean, yeah. What, if you told me $6,000, I would have been like
the small version. I'll get the actual size on
it
that
looks
one.
It's pretty small in the photos.
It's pretty small. It is pretty small. It's it.
I feel like it has a ways to go before it's going to be like widely adopted and.
Oh yeah, yeah.
It'll be a while for sure before we get it. But
but I could see a bigger company taking this kind of technology, just buying it. And applying it to
even in like a cell phone, it'd be pretty cool.
Yep, it would be. Yeah,
you could figure it out.
It'd be
but
really
it's in a
cool.
box right now.
It's like, in a box
I feel
right
like
now.
The box is what's doing the magic right now. Somehow.
It is.
I want to know how it works.
Mm-hmm. We go through it. Mm-hmm. Partially in the video that we do have, just kind of explaining some of the technology. So it's the box and it's the way the light's displayed through it. And obviously, there's some proprietary technology in there that they use.
Mirrors.
Mirrors, yeah. Right. It's mirrors and lasers. So it's a combination of light field and volumetric display technology, which...
Get lasers involved.
It's lasers.
And I'm on board.
It's lasers and lights. So there we go. But that kind of thing. So Looking Glass, again, is what that one's called. You can check that out at digitaltrends.com. I would love some kind of a television for that, although I'm seeing in the chat, Keelan just said, I can't wait for 3D frogs. So that's what they were showing the frog
like
in there.
3D frogs.
Yeah.
You can actually see them
I'm going to guess there
life.
May have been a little sarcasm
IRL.
In that comment.
I caught a frog the other day.
You did?
Yeah.
A 3D frog?
No, a little tiny, yeah. 3D.
Why are you catching
life?
Frogs, Caleb?
It was hopping through my garden. And I thought it was cute, so I caught it.
That's a little tidbit for the whiskers out there.
The whiskers, the whiskers may forget that the whiskey mist grew up in Texas and Alabama, where catching frogs is just something you do. That crawdad fishing.
Something you do.
Yep.
You know, then you boil them up with some taters.
You eat them. Yep.
Maybe some corn in there.
Yep. Some sausage.
See, if you get the Lenovo Smart Display at home, you can cook with whiskey mist as he teaches you how to cook frogs.
Whiskey
or whatever it
mist
is.
Can cook. I can get down in the kitchen.
I believe it.
I think that a whiskey mist cooking show, me and Kim ought to do something.
Let's do it.
That would be so fun. All right. We're going to work that out on the side. We'll just know that's something that could happen. Weigh in, viewers. If
look
you're,
for that
whiskey.
If you like to see a whiskey mist cooking show,
let us know.
Comment
what
right
do you
now.
Want him to whisk?
What's he whisking today? All right, let's get back on track.
All I make is souffle.
By the way,
it's a different flavor souffle every week.
It's the same.
This one's
thing.
Chocolate again.
He's going to change it up. No, he didn't. No.
This is boring.
All right, let's get to our final topic here that I want to bring up because this is something I have dreamed about having, and I think a lot of people since you were a kid, and it is having your own personal jetpack. And we've seen lots of promises of jetpacks through the years, and some that have been sold, some that some of the ones that work through water, and this seems like something that is actually on sale. Well, it is on sale. It's something you can buy right now, and it's an Iron Man style suit available for only $446,000.
Bargain.
You can pick one up right now. It's on sale at a department store in London, which I thought was hilarious. Selfridges. You can walk in and pick this up.
Oh, so they don't have it at Kohl's?
They don't have it at Kohl's yet.
Because Kohl's has like this weird electronic section in it where you're walking around, it's like shoes and socks and you got some jackets over there. And then all of a sudden it's just like, whoa, what's this TV doing here? Or they have freaking smartwatches and just random smatterings.
That's Selfridges, though. Selfridges is like, you can go and get like weird old people candy. Mm-hmm. Or
Werther's original.
Yeah.
Yeah, yes. Or
candy.
Flying Tony Stark suit.
Wonderful.
Well, and that's so
something
talking about this.
Everyone.
So this jet suit, and the reason it's being called like an Iron Man Tony Stark suit is one, you have a really sweet helmet, but two, like how it works, it's the propulsion is actually on your arms. So you have these two on each arm. You have two different propulsion devices that push you up through the air. It's really hard to explain.
Have you ever noticed
until you watch the video? What's that?
Every time you see one of these, people look super dumb flying in them. Have you ever noticed that? This person looks so
dumb, but they probably feel cool.
Oh my God.
It's like everybody's doing the robot and they fly.
Yeah.
I can imagine there's a learning curve for that thing. Definitely.
Well, he is saying, so here's what this guy's talking about with this, and it's British inventor Richard Browning.
Hmm.
So British inventor Richard Browning with his jet-propelled suit. And he's saying that it doesn't take very much to learn how to use it. And he's also claiming so that you don't need a license to fly it. Apparently in England you don't, or Great Britain.
That's going to need to change.
Which that's a little bit scary in its own right. It said that they had a pilot with 5 minutes of training who managed to hover untethered very happily he wrote. Those were his words. Very happily.
He was quite satisfied with his hovering.
A lot does depend on fitness level and aptitude. And so it's...
Aptitude. In other words, idiots need not apply.
Right?
Idiots
need not apply. Don't be overweight and do not...
Right, yeah.
And do not be drunk.
Yeah.
Right. Be drunk.
Don't... But but the thing is, though, it is on sale. It's something you can actually buy. Now, the Iron Man side.
First music video.
I should note, it doesn't have weapons. As Keelan just noted, if the propulsion is on your arm, there's no room for weapons. There are no weapons on
the screen. That's a concern.
That's a concern.
If you're calling it an Iron Man suit.
Where do I put
Somebody's picking apart our headline.
Right.
Okay.
They're picking apart our headline. And fair, you're right. There's no freaking
weapons.
But
it's Iron Man style.
It flies.
Right. Right. I mean, you have to assume you're not going to have the missiles.
Dude, this is
you need to be rich to own it.
This has been 4 decades in the making.
Yes,
I don't know. I'm sure our audience doesn't remember this, but back in the day, there were TV shows like The $6 Million Man, The Fall Guy,
that James Bond movie where he goes.
Yep, and in the James Bond movies, the old school jetpacks have been around for a long time. We've been trying to make this work for at least 4 decades, and now that you can actually buy one, I feel like that's a big moment. Like,
it is.
It's ridiculously expensive. Still, you can buy 2 houses for that in some spots in the U.S. Uh-huh. Definitely not here in Oregon, though. but still, that's like that's a lot of money for a jet suit. You know, let it come down in price and be more along the lines of a Toyota.
Well,
and then we can talk.
He did say that they're working on lowering the price eventually. They're also working on an electric version that would be available. That would be a lot less.
So the other thing that's Prius.
Yeah, basically. Like? I don't know if I want the jetpack.
No, I don't want the jetpack Prius.
That's not something you skip on.
I don't want to run out of battery. That's a concern.
Yeah. No.
Cruising over a bridge. The traffic and you run out of battery.
Well, one of the other cool things that they have is with the helmet.
Fair.
There's a heads-up display on the helmet that displays how much fuel you have left and probably other things, although he doesn't say anything else.
But it doesn't say things like Jarvis does.
I don't know if it does. I don't think so. You could probably put maybe once it's Alexa enabled.
Ooh, that's a great idea.
Alexa enabled.
Give Alexa a Jarvis voice.
Oh.
And just let you address it as Jarvis.
Yeah.
That's what they need to do.
There we go.
They need to do that.
We've solved the tech problems of the world. Attention, Amazon.
Yep.
Get a hold of us right now.
Do you get good
Didn't
nuggets
Zuckerberg
out of this
show? Didn't Zuckerberg get a bunch of publicity for doing that recently?
You never know.
Didn't Zuckerberg do something like that? Change the sound of like a voice assistant to be someone famous.
Google did
John
that.
Legend did for Google. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know why. I thought it was Zuckerberg.
Well, we didn't solve that one then. Anyway. Either way, Iron Man style suit available now. I would absolutely fly in this thing. If they want to do any kind of a video for live trends with benefits in a jetpack, that's whatever. I will absolutely try it. Would you try it right now?
Oh, hell yeah.
Yeah.
It would be so awesome. Like, just so cool. Can we get one to test?
I'm more like...
Drew on that?
Yeah, we should. Drew needs to get on that.
Yeah.
I'm more interested in, like, a personal helicopter or personal drone. Like, and there's one that's going to be tested out in New York City here pretty soon.
A personal
helicopter. It's like a personal quadcopter, basically. Mm-hmm. All electric, and I think it's all electric. The same company, I'm forgetting the name of it. I'll think of it in a second. Makes a new electric pickup truck.
Okay.
That's really meant for like work fleets, you know, and it looks super cool. But they're also working on this personal, like a quadcopter type thing that they say like pretty much anybody should be able to figure out how to fly.
Huh.
And I know they're working with the FAA really closely to, you know, see how they can make this legitimate and how there could be licenses. And of course, you know, navigating the skies, you've got to be careful. But
right.
But that's what I'm into. I love flying and I love the idea of being able to fly myself.
Especially with traffic.
But you don't want to pay for parking with your personalized.
Well, couldn't it like fly in and get you?
I don't know.
Somewhere out.
Oh, yes.
You know, you pay some farmer for 10 square feet of his field, and then when you need it, you like.
Just go.
Smartwatch.
Smartwatch it back down to you.
Yeah, just swoops right in and grabs you out of it.
That seems
you're
like
in an awkward conversation with somebody. You just hit the button and.
This seems like a way more legitimate style of transportation, though. Like that jetpack, you know, where are you going to put that when you get to work? Nowhere. Like,
it's not that big.
You don't fly.
I mean,
yeah.
It's the same size.
That's a fun.
if people can have space to put their bikes, you should have space to put your jetpack.
We'll make a jetpack rack over near the bike rack.
Yeah, we'll just get rid of the bike rack and replace it with a jetpack rack.
Fine. Sure. And people who still like cycling can still move their legs while they're
for a self-driving van. Put a drum set in the back of there.
Go to take a nap while it drives you to your gig.
Yeah.
We just went somewhere else.
All right. Well, there we go. Either way.
It really is a dream.
I feel like Greg is just given up. Like, he used to herd this cat.
Well, it's been a while since you've been on here, so I want to. I'm kind of letting the.
He's letting the misters get what they want.
The
whiskers needed to have a little bit.
You're the cat.
The whiskers.
You're the cat.
I called them the misters, and that's not.
Every now and then, you got to let the show just go.
The whiskers and the misters.
You got to give it a light mist.
Right. Well, you've all been misted today, so this has been.
How's it feel, guys?
Our episode of Trends and Benefits.
Shudder.
Again, we're a podcast. Hit subscribe on the podcast button wherever you get yours. That's really important. That way you make sure you get this episode every week. And every week we have different topics. And we can definitely take advice if you have some questions, comments, things you think that we should talk about. Send us an email, podcast@digitaltrends.com. And we will get on those. We have reviews of everything that we talked about on the show today that you can check out at digitaltrends.com. And thanks for watching. We'll be back next week with another episode. Oh, yeah. It's our cooking episode next week.
Oh, yeah. Souffle with whiskey.
Surprise, souffle.
Everybody take a double shot.